You go ahead, please turn in your Bible, find the book of 1 Samuel again, and we're going to do yet another study on what we called the secret anointing. The secret anointing. We've had part one of this message already. I'll review it very quickly for those of you that were not here to hear it. You can pick it up in the resource room, but secret anointing. It occurred to me that God did something that seemed unusual in the life of David, in that God anointed him to be king secretly. And that anointing was probably, depending on how you work together the chronology of his life, probably about 15 years before he actually became king. And when he became king, they anointed him publicly. And I got to thinking about that. Why was there a secret anointing? Why would God anoint him if it was just to become king, when he wouldn't become king for many more years? When you look at the life of Saul in 1 Samuel chapter 9, you see the same thing happened to Saul. He had a secret anointing. The prophet Samuel got him down off a rooftop. He had no clue he was going to be anointed to be king. He thought he was looking for some missing donkeys. And the prophet said, come on down from the roof and then send your servant away. So it was just Saul and Samuel, and there was a secret anointing and then a public anointing later. Why is there a secret anointing? And that's kind of at the heart of what we're talking about in this mini-series, the secret anointing. Because I want you to know you have a secret anointing also. But why? Why is it that God did that for both of these, the first two kings of Israel, a secret anointing and then later a public anointing? Well, here's the most important principle I want you to grab. We talked about it in part one. We'll add more to it this week. It is simply this: that which is done in secret is what determines your destiny. It is not what you and I do in public that determines our destiny. Your destiny is determined by your secret life, by your private life, by your heart life. Guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flow the issues of life. More than any other factor, it is what's done in secret, in the quietness of your own heart, that determines destiny. And so it makes perfect sense to me that being true, that what happens in secret is what determines our destiny, that God would have a special anointing for us. An anointing on that private area of our life. An anointing on the secret part, the quiet part, the alone part of our life that no one else sees. For it is that part of your life that determines your destiny. Your destiny is not decided by your employer or by world events or by anybody else outside doing anything for or against or to you. Your destiny is determined by what goes on inside your heart, in quietness, in aloneness, secret. And so, I believe there's a prophetic picture here of a secret anointing and a public anointing. And we are very concerned about public anointing, that we're able to do things for God in front of other people. But what's far more important than that is what takes place when it's just you and God. That's what determines your destiny. And so by way of a quick review, we saw in 1 Samuel 16:13 that it was just his family present. There was an anointing upon David. In verse 13 of that chapter, it says the Spirit of the Lord came upon him from that day on. What do we mean by anointing? Let's define it real quickly. What does it mean when we say anointing? You hear that a lot in Christianity, the anointing. What is anointing? What does that mean? Well, let's make it real simple. The word in Hebrew means to smear upon, to pour upon. Thus, when they poured the oil upon him, they said he was anointed. It means to pour upon, to smear upon, and it was even used to paint upon. The word in Hebrew was used that way. But let's make it real simple. When we talk about the anointing, we're talking about enablement. It is what the Spirit of God enables you to do. And God wants to enable you to serve Him. He wants to enable you to fulfill His plan and your destiny. He wants to enable you to share His love with others. The anointing basically should be thought of in terms of an enablement. It is what the Spirit of God moving in our hearts and upon our lives, what He enables us to do. It is an enablement. And so now the question in reference to David is real simple. What did the secret anointing enable him to do? To turn it around a little bit from the human perspective, how did he use the secret anointing? How do you use the anointing on your life? What is it that the anointing is enabling you to do that you are consciously and very specifically doing in your life under that anointing? And that's a very, very pivotal question in your life, because what's done in secret is what determines your destiny. Well, David basically was three things. The first one we saw in part one, David became under the anointing. David became a worshiper. There in the quietness, in the aloneness of the hillside, while he was shepherding his father's flock, what did David do? What did he do with those hours that many people would deem boring? What did he do with the aloneness? What did he do with the quietness? What did he do in secret? He worshiped. He became a worshiper of God. And in part one, we saw how worship enabled him to fulfill his destiny, because it was in those times of worship that he found fulfillment in the presence of the Lord. And that is what enabled him to wait. Saul couldn't wait. It is important that we learn to wait on God, to wait for him to do things in our lives, to follow his instructions. And if we're not people of worship, we will not be able to wait, because we're always looking for fulfillment from somewhere else. We also saw that worship was the key to David overcoming life's greatest wounds and hurts. When he was stabbed in the back by his friend, when he was rebelled against by his son, how did he handle it? He worshiped. He wrote psalms. He took it to God in songful prayer. We call that psalms. He worshiped. And worship was an arena in which he learned trust. How did David become a worshiper? Was it in the courts of Saul, playing the 10-string instrument, soothing that distressing spirit that would come upon Saul? That's not where he became a worshiper. That's where he expressed his worship. But he became a worshiper in secret. Are you? Am I? And there is an anointing that will enable us to do just that. Ephesians 5 talks about being continually filled with the Holy Spirit. How do we do that? With psalms and hymns, singing to yourself and making melody with psalms and hymns and songs of the Spirit. It's how we are continually refreshed in the Spirit. There's an anointing for that. Well, now today we want to take another step forward. What else was David? Well, David was a shepherd. We're not going to talk about that today. He was a great leader. He not only was a great shepherd of sheep, but he became a great leader of men, both before he was king and as king he was a great king. So he was a leader, a shepherd. But I want to talk to you today about David as a warrior. David was a mighty warrior. We read through the scriptures and we overlook how great a warrior David really was. The most famous story of David is David and Goliath. That's war. The Philistines were lined up on one side. Israel was lined up on another side. And Israel was cowering in their trenches. And out comes giant Goliath. That was war. That was war. We see many times, and there's scriptures you can get off the screen or off our study guide. You can look them up more on your own. But David was a mighty warrior. Saul would send him out on missions, and David would always come back triumphant. So much so that the ladies made up a song, not just after Goliath, but after other missions, that David would come back, and the ladies would sing, "Saul has slain his thousands, and David has slain his tens of thousands." That song did not do David any favors, as it only stimulated Saul's jealousy. But notice, he was known as a warrior. Here's an example, and I know it's kind of gruesome and bloody and not a part of our culture, but he was promised the king's daughter in marriage, but he's a poor boy. He's a shepherd boy. How is he going to afford the dowry for a king's daughter? Well, Saul wanted him killed. Saul didn't want him around. So Saul said, "Here's the price, 100 foreskins of the Philistines." That's not going to be an easy thing. You got to be a warrior to do that. He didn't come back with 100 foreskins. He came back with 200 foreskins. There are many times, even before he was king, that David, with just a ragtag army of men, all the rejects of Israel come and gather around him at the cave of Adullam. But under his leadership, they all became warriors. They were later on referred to as mighty men. They won incredible victories, supernatural victories. I think of the time where the city of Keilah was overrun by the Philistines, and David prays and he says, "Lord, should I go deliver Keilah?" And the Lord said, "Yeah, go deliver it." And he does, and he sets them free. And then they pray, "Lord, are they going to betray me? Are they going to turn me over?" Saul, "Yeah, they will." That was the story of his life for several years, winning great military victories and then having to go run high. mighty kings that he defeated. You read 2 Samuel chapter 22, and it chronicles some of the greatness of David as a warrior, as a man of battle. And we're going to look today specifically at that first great public battle was David and Goliath. And you say, but wait a minute. I thought David was a man after God's own heart. Yes, indeed. That's exactly right. Do you know God is a warrior? We don't think of that. God is a warrior. There are many scriptures where Exodus 15:3, for example, the Lord is a man of war. And many times you read in the scripture, the Lord will fight for his people. Nehemiah 4:20, he says, when you hear the sound of the trumpet while we're working on the wall, everybody assemble at that sound because the Lord will fight for us there. God was known as a warrior. And David was a warrior. And we read even in the days of Hezekiah, who very much learned from David, was able to stand up when he was under an incredible attack from an overwhelming enemy. And Hezekiah was able to say to the people, with him, meaning the enemy, is the arm of the flesh, but with us is the Lord our God. He will fight for us. I want you to get that in your mentality when you pray. I want you to get that in your mentality that there is conflict. There is war. Now, in the New Testament era, it's of a spiritual nature, but you got to know how to do spiritual warfare. Where do we learn that? Turn with me, if you would, to 1 Samuel 17. And it is a very familiar passage. Scripture is a very familiar story. It is the story of how God used David to slay Goliath. But I want you to read something because that's public. That's out in front of the whole armies of the Philistines and the whole armies of Israel. And that was a very public event. When we're talking about the secret anointing, what is it that enabled David to face off with a giant and win? What is it that allowed him to do that? Where did he get that kind of training? Now, here's the scenario. Here's what's happening. The two armies are lined up, and it was what they call the concept of a champion. I'm not going to have time to get into that, but it was like a representative fighting on behalf of the whole army. And Goliath comes out as the champion of the Philistines, and he is defying the armies of God. Meanwhile, shepherd boy David is sent by dad down to deliver food and see how his brothers are doing, the soldiers. And David is disturbed that everybody's hiding in the trenches, and no one is addressing this giant. And that offends the heart of David. Why? David's a warrior. It's in his heart. It's already in his heart to be a warrior. And he hears the taunting in the name of the gods of the Philistines, taunting not only the armies of Israel, but in effect taunting the God of Israel. And this offends the warrior heart of David. David is bothered that no one is getting out of the trenches. And so David goes to the king and says, I'll fight him. But you're just a boy. Who are you to fight him? What qualifies you to fight him? I want you to read with me his response. First Samuel chapter 17, this is David's answer to Saul. And it's as if David is begging to get at the giant. That's the heart of a warrior. Everybody else is cowering in the shadows of the trenches, hiding, plugging their ears like they don't hear those taunts from the giant. But David is begging to have at it. That's the heart of a warrior. And Saul says, what qualifies you? You're just a kid. I mean, this giant out there, he's been trained in war for many years. He's been trained as a warrior since he was a kid. You're still a kid. Why do you think you can fight him? And the enemy intimidates many of us today, especially the Christian church. Many of us in the Christian church never step into the battle arena because we're intimidated by the enemy, and we have no qualification to go fight him that we know of. And yet I want to tell you today, there is a secret anointing that will make a warrior out of you. The kingdom of God needs some more godly warriors. And Saul says in verse 33, well, why do you think you can do it? You're just a youth. Verse 34, here's David's answer. I love this. Look at the boldness. This isn't arrogance. It's confidence. There's a difference. But David said to Saul, your servant used to keep his father's sheep, and when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went out after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it rose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck it and killed it. I don't know about you, but I'm looking at it. I said, whoa, slow down, David. Tell me about that. Nobody saw that. David said, well, you know why I can fight the giant? You know why I will go out and fight him in the name of the Lord? Because one day when I was watching my father's sheep, a bear came along. I want you to just recreate the scenario in your mind. And David says, and he took one of the lambs. Now, if it was me, if I was a shepherd and he took one of the lambs, you know what I would have been thinking? Let's see, how many do I have left? I think we'll be all right. I mean, every shepherd loses one once in a while. What's the big deal? I better be on better guard against the bear next time. But that's not the heart of a warrior. And look at what the warrior heart of David does. David says, I was watching my father's sheep and a lion and a bear. He doesn't even say which one was which, but it happened with a lion. It happened with a bear. He said, well, just take the lion first. The lion comes along and he grabs one of the sheep. He says, so what did I do? I went after it. You chase a lion? He said, what's the worst thing that happened? The worst thing is you can catch it. I don't know if you should be chasing lions. And so he said, I went after it. Notice what he says. And I struck it. What did he strike it with? I don't know. It doesn't say. I'm guessing a slingshot. The rock of the sling. Because what do you do when you're alone? You worship. You praise. Then you say, I think I can hit that tree. And you practice your slingshot when you're all alone. But he says the bear went down. The lion went down. But he got back up again. So notice what David does. He doesn't say, hey, I'm glad I scared that bear off. He says, I grabbed him by the beard. I grabbed him by the hair of his chinny chin chin. I grabbed him by the beard, and I pulled that lamb out of his mouth, and I struck him again and killed him. Now, who saw that? Who witnessed that? Nobody. That was done in secret. How did he do that? How was he enabled to do that? He did that under the secret anointing. It was the anointing that he received from God in secret that allowed him to do some things in secret. Yes, he was a great worshiper for God, of God in secret, but he was a great warrior for God. And it starts here, in secret. Where nobody's looking, nobody sees. Matter of fact, would anybody have even known had he not done it? Would anybody have cared that they lost the lamb? I mean, after all, they'd still reproduce. There's more to come. But I want you to know something. You're going to see this as a pattern later. David chases after the lion, the bear. He strikes the lion, the bear. The lion, the bear goes down. David witnesses the lion, the bear getting back up, so he strikes it again. He's right there, hand to hand. I grab his beard. I don't know about you, that's awesome. To see a young teenager doing stuff like this. Was he doing it for the applause of men? Was he doing it to be seen? No, it was in secret. This is what prepared him to be a man of war. This is what prepared him for God. And let's read on what he says. He said, I grabbed by the beard, I struck it, I killed it. Verse 36, your servant has killed both lion and bear. Now that's more than one. Your servant has killed both lion and bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God. Moreover, David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. All right, go ahead and do it then. I just want to give you some scriptures here, but before I do, get ready to write these three down. I'm going to give you three principles. We're dealing with principles in our secret life. Three principles. Principle number one, private victories always precede public victories. Andrew gave me a book to peruse. It was Seven Habits of Highly Effective People or something like that. He's always given me books. He gave me one book, Leadership Qualities of Attila the Hun. I don't even know where he gets these books. But this one is a bestseller. This is a good book. He gave me this book, so I'm leaving through it. And I just was leaping through it and jumped right off the page. Private victories always precede public victories. That's David. Before you get to Goliath, you better know how to deal with the lion and the bear. Before you do anything publicly, you better have some victory privately. And principle number one for today is simply this. Private victories will always, underline, circle, bold print the word always, private victories will always precede public victories. You don't just march out in the arena and become victorious. There's things that must be done in secret under the anointing, the enabling, the assisting of the Holy Spirit, or you will never have public victory. Private victories always precede public victories. And I would say the flip side of that is true as well. That private compromises always precede public collapses. But long before you see someone humiliated in public or,
or something collapse, or someone's life just fall all apart morally, spiritually. It always began in the secret place. It always began with secret compromises that nobody knew about, that nobody could tell, maybe even for years. But it goes back to our very first principle. That which is done in secret is what determines your destiny. David, you are destined to be a warrior. You are destined to fight the enemies of God. You are destined to be a man of courage and skill and war. But you're not going to learn it publicly. You're going to learn it quietly. Because the greatest training is the training of the heart. And I read some of these scriptures from David. Look, for example, in Psalm chapter 18, in verse 34, he says this a couple times. He says, "He teaches my hands to make war so that my arms can bend a bow of bronze. You have also given me the shield of your salvation. Your right hand has held me up. Your gentleness has made me great. You enlarged my path under me so my feet did not slip. I have pursued my enemies and overtaken them. Neither did I turn back till they were destroyed. I have wounded them so that they could not rise. They have fallen under my feet. You have armed me with strength for the battle. You have subdued under me those who rose up against me. You've given me the necks of my enemies so that I destroyed those who hated me." That's the heart of a warrior. I mean, look at verse 42. He says, "Then I beat them as fine as the dust before the wind. I cast them out like dirt in the streets." I mean, he's getting kind of carried away there, isn't he? "I not only defeated them, you gave me their necks. I turned them into dust. I trampled them under my feet." I mean, he said, "Lord, you taught my hands to do it." This is the heart that is developing in him. So here comes Goliath out in public, and everybody else is hiding in fear, but David has had some secret experiences. David has had some experiences under the anointing of the Holy Spirit that nobody ever saw before. And it was those experiences that caused him to get out there on the battlefield and say, "This Philistine is just going to be like lion and bear. Each one, I was delivered from each one. This Philistine is going to be the same." You know why? Because David later on in Psalms would say, "I didn't trust in my bow. I did not trust in my sword. I trusted in the Lord." And he learned that in the secret place. He learned that in the private place, in the inner resources of his own heart. That's where he learned that. Psalm 144 echoes these words. "Blessed be the Lord my rock, who trains my hands for war and my fingers for battle. My loving kindness and my fortress, my high tower, my deliverer, my shield, the one in whom I take refuge, who subdues my people under me." There you see it again. David saying that the Lord is my shield. And Psalm 27, "The Lord is the light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise against me, in this will I be confident." This is a heart of a warrior. In Psalm 28, he says, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song I will praise him." Listen to Psalm 44, verses 4 through 8. He says in Psalm 44, 4 through 8, he says these words, "You are my king, O God. Command victories for Jacob. Through you we will push down our enemies. Through your name we will trample those who rise against us. I will not trust in my bow, nor shall my sword save me, but you have saved us from our enemies and have put to shame those who hated us. In God we boast all day long. Praise your name forever." Did you hear? He says, "I don't trust in my bow. I don't trust in my sword. I trust in you." Well, where did he learn that? Under the anointing of the Holy Spirit on his life when he was all alone. He said, "Well, that, is this just a Sunday school story? Did you really believe this happened?" "Yeah, I believe it happened. I believe he grabbed a bear by the beard. I believe he did it. He said it. I believe these scriptures are inspired by God. Nobody else saw it, but he did it." Everybody saw it through Goliath. But before he did Goliath, he did that battle in the secret place. Now here's my point. I'm going to jump now. Come with me. You have some secret battles to play too. There are lions and bears that want to rob the flock that God has entrusted to you. Your own heart, your own family. And there are battles that you must fight, and you must only fight them in secret. The world will never see you fight. But if you do not win these battles, you will not win the battle. If you do not win the battle, private, when you're all alone in the secrecy of your own heart, if you and I don't learn how to win those battles, we will never be qualified to face the Goliath. Because that which is done in secret is what determines our destiny. And I want to encourage you today, God wants you to win. God has an anointing, not just so when you stand in front of people and share Jesus and share his love, that he enables you to do that. Anointing is enablement. Not just so that when you pray for somebody, you know that God's going to do something because you're praying and there is an anointing, there is an enablement. But God also wants you to know today that you have battles to be fought, and the world will not see these battles, but the world will eventually know the outcome of them. Because if we fail in the secret place, we will eventually fail in the public place. But if we prevail in the secret place, we will conquer in the public place. And before a battle is ever won in public, it must first be won in secret. And nobody was there to see the lion. Nobody was there to see the bear. That was secret, but David fought it. He didn't just say, oh, well, it doesn't matter. He fought it. And right now, there are lions and bears that are fighting against you where you fight. There are lions and bears that come along and try to rob just a lamb here out of your heart, just a lamb there out of your flock. Nobody's looking, and nobody will know. That's what will determine destiny. And I want to remind you, it's not just your own destiny that hangs in the balance. Those of us that are heads of tribes, family, our children, our grandchildren, their destinies depend on whether or not you and I will fight, whether you and I will stand up for what is right and good and godly, whether you and I will do battle in spiritual places and heavenly realms. And where do we learn that? In the secret place. But I want to encourage you, there is a secret anointing to enable you to do that. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11, Peter says these words are easy to just gloss right over. He says, abstain from fleshly lusts that war against your soul. There are things that we could label using the picture story we're creating of lion and bear and privacy. There are lions and bears that come to us in the form of thoughts and lusts and desires that come to us in the form of secret habits and we don't fight those battles, we will never prevail against God. He says, abstain against fleshly lust, that war. Notice the word he used, that Peter used. This is a war. Your soul is at stake. You've got to learn how to win those battles. And it's, he says in 1 Peter 5, he says, the devil is like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. We have an enemy out there, and the enemy comes to us, not just with demons. I believe we have authority over demons. But I believe there are lions and bears that attack what God has invested into our life, what God has entrusted into our life. Trying to rob just a little here, just a little there. You know what? If you never fight a lion, you never fight a bear, one day you will wake up and you won't have a flock. And we've got to learn how to fight these battles. And Romans 7, Paul talks about that battle within himself. Things I want to do, I don't end up doing. The things I don't want to do, I end up doing. He says, I see another law. It's in my members. And he talks about this war between flesh and spirit. And even in Galatians 5, he says, for the flesh and the spirit, they're at war. If you lose that battle, you lose it all. Oh, people might not see it. It might not catch up to you for a long time, but it will. Like private victories always precede public victories, private compromises always precede public collapses. It's the same way. You're defeated in this realm, this secret realm, this private realm, this realm that nobody knows about but you. Nobody knows. You don't know the battles I fought this week. You don't know. They're mine. They're secret. They're private. And I don't know the battles you had to fight, but I know if you don't fight them, we will lose. Private victories always precede public victories. And turn with me to a classic passage on spiritual warfare, but let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I want to show you this. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I want to show you where these lions and these bears oftentimes attack us. In Song of Solomon chapter 2, verse 15, it says, catch the little foxes that spoil the vine. See, they might be just little thoughts, little desires, little attitudes, little habits. They're not out there in public. They're just in the resources of our own. In the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, meaning fleshly or of the flesh, but but are mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Where is the battleground? He talks about imaginations. He talks about thoughts that become strongholds to keep people bound. There are people that cannot serve God the way they desire to serve God because there are strongholds that are keeping them bound. And those strongholds are in the secret places of their life. In those thought areas, those imagination areas. And they become so entrenched. They're not free. They are lions and bears coming to rob the flock. I believe that's why David prayed in Psalm 139, 23, and 24. He said, Lord, search me, know my heart. See if there's anything in me that's out of line. See if there's anything inside of me that's out of line. See if there's anything in me that nobody else sees that needs to be dealt with. I don't believe we need to be self-condemning, but I do believe we need to open our hearts to the Holy Spirit and say, Lord, the battles be fought right here on this battleground. And I need your anointing to win. There's something about David that he would not tolerate one single lamb being was an attitude of a warrior David that said, no, I'm just not going to put up with this. And one of the reasons that we do not live in greater victory and greater righteousness, those two are tied together in the kingdom, is because of the things we tolerate. It's not always the things that we actively are participating in openly, but they are the things that we are allowing, the things that we just don't get disgusted enough to fight. Commercial the other day. It was a very lust-filled sexual commercial. I was ashamed to even let my eyes gaze upon it, to be honest with you. And I don't stand before you as some pristine, pure person. I battle that. I saw that commercial, and late in the day, I said to my wife, I'm never gonna eat in that restaurant. Because they sell hamburgers by peddling sex. I just don't want to give my money. I'm just not going to do it. See, I didn't like that about myself. Me that I would even be attracted to that. So am I going to fight that battle? Am I going to say that is a lion that's trying to take something that God has put within me, and I will not tolerate it within myself? I'm not out here to judge you. The battlefield is not between you and me, between some preacher pounding his legalism on you. That's not the battleground. The battleground is your own heart, you and God. That's where the lions and the bears want to rob the flock, and nobody's looking but you and God. And what will we tolerate? What will we excuse? What will we say? Oh, it just doesn't matter. Nobody knows. I didn't hurt anybody. You hurt your soul. And the more you hurt your soul, the less you will be able to fight a Goliath someday. And the whole nation might depend on you fighting Goliath. And your grandchildren might depend on you fighting the Goliath. But it's what we do in secret that determines our destiny. It's the small foxes that spoil the vine. We let all that stuff add up, think it doesn't matter. No, it does matter. And I'm not telling you to condemn yourself. I'm just telling you to see what is not right within our own hearts and fight. And know that it is not your own strength that will win. It is not. You know what? Fighting in your own strength, that's religion, that's legalism. You'll never win that way. You just create a greater monster called spiritual pride. And you end up bound up anyway. There is an anointing of the Holy Spirit to enable you to win victories in the superior spirit. There is an anointing of the Holy Spirit that will allow you to face off with a lion and a bear and see victory. It's in the secret places. A little leaven leavens a whole lump. It's not enough to say, oh, it doesn't matter. It's not that big. No, it is. It matters. It all adds up. It's a secret place. Inner strength. Listen to these Proverbs. Proverbs 16:32. He who rules the spirit is more mighty than he who takes the city. It's more important that you have control over your own inner life, your own spirit, than being able to conquer a city. Proverbs 28, verse 28 of chapter 25 is the opposite. The one who does not rule his own spirit is like a city without walls. In other words, anybody can conquer that city until you learn to have rule of your spirit. Why don't we have rule over our spirit? Because there's lions and bears always trying to nip away at it. There is an anointing. It'll teach your hands to war. There is an anointing whereby you go before God and you say, God,
jealousy. Read about it in 18 and 19 chapters, 18 and 19 of 1 Samuel, and see how when he hears the praises going David's way, of course he had already fallen away from grace because he couldn't wait. Why couldn't he wait? He didn't worship. Saw that last time. Disobeyed the Lord. When he saw the sweet anointing on David's worship, when he saw the warrior anointing on David's battle and his conflict, Saul became a spiritual. Why? Because there was something in his heart that he wouldn't allow God to deal with. He lost the inner battle. And you and I, we become spear throwers and we become manipulators and all these kinds of things when we're not winning the inner battle. When we say, I don't trust in my spear, I don't trust in my bow. I've learned to trust in the Lord. And where do you learn that trust? When some bear comes along and tries to rob your flock and you sense something allowing you to rise up and confront it, chase it down and beat it. Notice David's aggressiveness. He chased the lion. But if you read the story of David and Goliath, it says when the Philistines took a step toward him, it says he hurried toward the armies of the Philistines. He rushed out running at that giant. I can just see this guy running at the giant, getting his sling ready, and boom, letting it fly. Where did he learn to do that? When he chased down a bear. When he chased down a lion. Now, here's principle number two. And don't worry, the last two are not going to be as long as the first one. First one is simply this: private victories will always precede public victories. Before you face Goliath, you got to face the lion and the bear in private. And that speaks of our own inner struggles, those things that we know rob and war against our soul, those thoughts, those habits, those attitudes that we've allowed to build up within us that need to be confronted. Only by you and God, not by religion, not by legalism, by a work of the Spirit. Principle number two. We must be proven in private. Just write that down. We must be proven in private. If you read on the story in chapter 17, 38 through 40, Saul says to David, David, you want to go fight that Goliath? You want to fight that giant? You think you've got some qualifications? Something happened with your dad and the sheep and a lion? Well, go ahead. The Lord be with you. And then he says, but here, take my armor. Here's my armor. See, the Israelites did not have metal. They didn't have swords, so there was very little armor or swords. And so Saul says, here, take my armor. So David puts it on, and he starts walking. And he says, no, I can't fight in these because I have not proven them. I have never put these to the test. Now get this. Because he had never worn them before, he could not wear them to fight the giant. Well, how would you prove them then? You have to prove them before you face the giant. You have to prove them in private. And we must be proven in private. David turns this into a psalm and a prayer in Psalm 26:2, where he asks the Lord to examine him and prove him. And the word nachan in the Hebrew simply means to put something to a test. However, when we look at the New Testament equivalent, we'll look at it in a moment, you're putting something to the test with the view toward approval. Doesn't always get approval, but that's the view you're looking at. We read about Hezekiah. God left him to Nachan to test him to see what was in his heart. He had to be proven. In the New Testament, dokimon, dokimazo is the Greek word. It says, let a deacon first be proven. And many times in the New Testament, that word proven, our faith must be proven. 1 Peter 1:7, faith that is tried in the fire, faith that is proven is more precious than gold. God allows people to go through hard times so that they as people must be proven. We read that in 1 Corinthians 11, that these divisions must have happened so that those that are approved of God have been tested and approved. They might be put on display. This is a principle that before you get to the big battlefield, the public battlefield, you must be proven in private. And how are you proven in private? By winning those battles nobody sees. By winning those battles under a secret anointing that nobody else but you and God know about. But that's what proves us in private. The Bible says, 1 Corinthians 3:13, same word we're looking at in the New Testament. It says every man's work will be proven by God. Every man's work is going to be put to a test, but the view is toward approving it. God wants something positive to come, so he allows you to be tested in private. He allows there to be times where it's just you and God, and there's a struggle, there's a wrestling match in prayer.
the stream. Jesus doesn't take any old rock. He feels the rock. And just picture David in your mind now, kind of moving his arm up and down like he said, yeah, this one's about the right weight. As his fingers wrap around, this is about the right size. Now, you wouldn't use the word aerodynamic, but this is a smooth one. It'll fly good. See, he chose his ammunition with his own hands, but where did he choose? Where was he when he was learning to do that? All alone. See, now, here's a prophetic picture. I believe that running stream that smoothed those stones, that is a picture of the moving of the Holy Spirit in my life. If the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty to God, the weapons of our warfare come from that moving of the Holy Spirit in our own life, smoothing out the stones. You might not be able to sling somebody else's stone. He smoothed out a stone just for you. I remember many years ago, and there was no one in this room, so don't go pointing fingers, but many years ago, some people came to me, and it was one of those emotional times that I felt emotionally hurt by, but I had to, you can't be a baby about everything. You just say, okay, God, I got to move on here. But a group of people had gotten together and had a meeting without me about me. That's not good. When they have a meeting about you without you, and they chose a representative, which was a dear friend of mine. And he came to me and says, we had a meeting. We were discussing your preaching, and we believe you need to change. We believe you need to tell more stories. We believe you use too many scriptures. And we're going to really grow this church. And you know what? That really, in a sense, what hurt me was that they talked about me without me. I understand in the public arena, people are going to critique what we do. That's a part of the whole thing. I was stewing about that. I said, should I change my preaching? Should I go just 20 minutes and lighten up and tell more stories and use less scripture and try and get a bigger crowd? Should I do that? And I really liked these people, and they were my friends telling me this. And we had a guy come to our church that I'd never met before, and he was preaching, and right in the middle of it, he stopped me, pointed at me, and he says, "Don't you put on anybody else's armor. Don't you ever wear somebody else's armor. Somebody else's armor is not going to fit you. And you can't wear Saul's armor, but you can't wear Jonathan. You got to be careful. You got to be careful that you get your stones from the river yourself. You can't depend on it. Even if it's from Jonathan, you depend on the Lord. And you get your stones from the river itself." I didn't get a word for word exactly what he said. But basically what he was saying to me was, hey, you be who I'm calling you to be. And that's not to say that we don't learn from criticism. And we don't grow. And we don't try to better ourselves. But there comes a time when we say, wait a minute, I can't wear somebody else's armor. That's their anointing. That's what God's doing in their life. I've got to go to the stream and feel the stones with my own hands and figure out what fits in my sling, and that's what I go to war with. And you only figure that out in private. You only get your stones when you spend time by the stream. And you sense the moving of God's precious Spirit in your own life, and you know what stone fits in your hand. And I don't know what to make of this. Maybe it's just a historical account. But I noticed as I was reading the story in 1 Samuel 17, twice it mentions the shepherd's bag. That David had this little bag that when he found a good stone, he put it in that bag. You need a shepherd's bag. You need to be able to find those things that God has done in your life and hang on to it, because you might need to someday to hurl at a giant. And he put this thing, and David, he took off that armor. He said, this doesn't fit me. It's not proven. I can't go to war in this. But what are you going to go to war with, David? Well, what was the only thing he knew? He didn't know how to use a sword. But when he was alone, he knew how to find the rocks that were just the right shape and smoothness and weight for his sling. So he went to the river, and he got five of them. That giant was taunting Israel. David's running after the giant. It says, it makes a note of this. Why? I don't know. It says he reaches into the bag and gets the stone that he picked from the stream. And I want to say, there are things that God's moving, God's Spirit is doing in your life, and maybe it's not doing much for you now, but put it in the bag. Someday there's a giant that needs that thing in the forehead. Someday that which God is smoothing out in your life is going to be something you will use for victory. Any secret times. If you don't have any private communion with God where you're learning to fight lion and bear, you'll reach in your bag and have nothing there. guys to quote. This is the last guy, one of the last guys I think I'd ever want to quote. But one of my favorite quotes of the Bible comes from Ahab. Don't name your kid Ahab. Ahab, I mean, Ahab is not one of the good guys in the Bible. But Ahab did say something that's powerful. He was being challenged by a king, an enemy king. And Ahab said this in 20:11 of Kings. He said this. He said, the man who's putting on his armor should not boast like the man who's taking it off. What does he mean by that? Until you've been through a few battles, you've got nothing to say. Until you put on the armor, gone to the field of battle, and then you won and you took it off, then you have something to say. You got something to boast about, not because you put on armor, but because you know you've been through the battle and you're taking it off. See, we need to go through some battles. Look at those things that God is revealing in your own heart, those lions and those bears, and say, I'm not going to let them take what God has invested into my life. I'm going to fight it. It's not going to be me. It's not going to be a carnal weapon. It's not going to be my flesh. It's not going to be religious. It's going to be something of the anointing of the Spirit of God. It's going to be the grace of God, the Spirit of God, doing something in my own heart, privately, me and God. Nobody can do that for you. Nobody can lay hands on you and presto, make it happen. No, it's you and God. You've got to go to the stream yourself. You've got to spend time there. Private victories always precede public victories. Number two, we must be proven in private under this secret anointing. And that's why it's so important. Don't try and do this by yourself. The Holy Spirit is your partner. The Holy Spirit is your friend. The Holy Spirit is your enabler. If you try to do this without the Holy Spirit, it turns to religious legalism and you're worse off than you ever were. This is grace. This is the Spirit of God enabling you what you cannot do and what you and I do not deserve to have done. Scenario as David recounted the lion bear. He said, I slew it. How do you say? We don't know. He didn't say. Did he get up close enough, hit it with a stick? And I think he used a sling, but we don't know. He said, I slew it. It went down. It got back up. Why is that important? You know what one of the biggest problems in counseling is? You give somebody the prescription of what they need to be doing in their life to change the situation, and they start doing it, and they start being a little better, and then they stop doing it. Like you're on antibiotics and you're supposed to take it for 8 days, you feel better after two, so you're going to save the rest for next time. Well, believe me, there'll be a next time. No, they won't work next time. You start feeling better, so you let it get back up. You're going to fight a lion, you're going to fight a bear. I'll tell you what, if you're close enough to grab its beard, you better make sure it stays down. Now, you read the story, and the Bible tells us the story from the perspective of the narrator in 1 Samuel 17. So in 1 Samuel 17, it says, David ran out toward the army of the Philistines, and he reached his bag, and he got his stone, and he hurled his stone, and he hit. I love that. This is a cool story, but it's true. And he hits the guy right, hits Goliath right in the forehead. It says the stone sunk in, and Goliath falls face down on the earth. So he's lying there. And the next verse says, David killed him. But that's the narrator saying that. Does David know Goliath is dead? Past, the lion got back up. In the past, the bear got back up. So read the story. What does David do? It says there was no sword in Israel. David did not have a sword. So he went over to that giant laying face down, that Goliath laying face down, and he pulled that big sword out of the sheath of Goliath. And it says, so he stood over the giant, and he took that sword, and he cut off his head. Why is that so important? Now there's a little... I don't know how it was written, whether this is a literary technique, because it says he took the armor, put it in his tent, and he took the head back to Jerusalem. And then the last paragraph, it says when Saul was saying, who is that guy? Who is that kid? When he comes before Saul, he has the head. But here's the thing we can know, the significant thing. David made sure the giant was dead. Maybe he was already dead from the sling, but David made sure those lions, those bears, those giants, attack our lives. Make sure they're good. Don't be content just with relief. We
what? I heard a guy, he was a faith guy, and he said, well, David didn't have faith. What do you mean David didn't have faith? How can you accuse David of not having faith when he faced Goliath? I mean, this is incredible that a kid would do this. And the guy, well, he must not have faith because he took 5 stones, so he must have thought he'd miss. Okay, you know, if I could take a whole tank, I'd take a whole tank. I'd take a whole arsenal if I had to. That's not lack of faith. But here's an interesting thing. Just the thought, food for thought. Write these scriptures down. 2 Samuel 21, 15 through 22. 1 Chronicles chapter 20, 4 through 8. Guess what? Goliath had 4 brothers. Now, it doesn't say this. It's purely speculative on my part. But maybe David was thinking, you know what? I'm going to get him all. I'm not only going to get this guy, but he's got some brothers. I better be ready to get them too. Is it just coincidental that there were 5 giants, Goliath and 4 brothers, and that he took 5 stones with him? Maybe it's coincidental, but I think it's interesting. If you read the names of these guys and who slew them, David didn't get to slay them all. Some of these other men slew them. Let me just give them to you real quickly, and then we'll have to close. And I gave you the scriptures where you can find these names. Ishibinab is the first one, the brother of Goliath. And you know what Ishibinab means? It means my dwelling is on high, or I belong on high. What does that sound like? Abishai, one of David's mighty men, slew this giant. But what does Abishai mean? In the Hebrew, the root of Abishai, the root itself that Abishai comes from, means shortest of all. That's a picture of humility. Humility slays pride. Another brother giant of Goliath was Saph, S-A-P-H. It means, Saph means two-faced. That's hypocrisy. We have to overcome hypocrisy, do that. This one is unproven, totally unproven, but their name is Shibahath. Guy who took him on and killed him, and some say that name means self-death. In other words, you die to self, that's what this means. Lammy is easy to figure out. Lammy means, that's another brother of Goliath, means my bread, my food. That speaks of appetites and passions. He was slain by a man by the name of Elhanan, and Elhanan means God's grace. But is it to get your passions and your appetites in God's grace? I love the last one. The last one doesn't give the name. He says he has 6 fingers. I'm not picking on you if you're hiding. What is that? When you think of 6 fingers, the grabber, greed. The guy who slew him was named Jonathan, and Jonathan means Jehovah has given. How do you overcome greed? By what God has given you, by taking him, what God has given you. Now, that's just food for thought, but here David, he comes out, he says, I it's not enough that I just scare away this giant. It's not, I got to make sure he's dead. It's not enough that I get my pride under control, which is no such thing. Romans chapter 8:13 says, if you through the Spirit, it's through the anointing, through the Spirit, if you through the Spirit mortify the deeds of the flesh, you will live. Allow the Spirit of God to put some things to death in us, then we have life. Colossians 3:5, mortify the deeds of the flesh. Romans chapter 6, the old man, the old nature must be crucified with Christ, for he who is dead is free from sin. It's not enough that we knock the giant down and move on for another day. No, we got to make sure he's dead. We got to make sure that, Jesus put it this way, if your hand is sinning, make sure it never does again. Cut it off. He's not teaching you to cut up your body. He's talking about dealing with things and making sure they're dealt with. I close by simply saying this to you. It's not just an anointing to preach, to share, or to pray, or to testify. But I believe you too have an anointing. And that anointing is not only enabling you to do things for God, but that anointing is enabling you to win victories in the secret places of your life. You can make a big deal over the Goliath. We need to think a little bit more about the lions and bears and take a lamb here, take a lamb there. We need to pray what David prays to search and know God's you that we need to listen up with you. You have an anointing. 1 Corinthians 1:21, that you anoint. God. 1 John 2:20-27, you have an anointing from the Holy One. I like what David sums up his life in 2 Samuel 22:40. I'll close with this. He says, for you have armed me with strength for the battle. You have subdued under me those who rose against me. You have armed me with strength for the battle. You and I have battles that need to be fought. The most important ones, the world.
They are the ones that we fight in the quietness of our own heart. They are the jealousies that we no longer allow to grow in our heart. They are the lusts that we no longer tolerate. They are the prideful attitudes that we say must have their head cut off. They are the lion and the bear that will continue to try and love us. Will we be mighty and allow God to teach our hands? Because someday there is a giant effort to do so. Someday there is a public victory for you to win, that all around you will rally and rejoice, and the victory will be shared with many. Right where you're standing, you'll simply say, Lord, you know, I got to admit, Lord, I've allowed this bear to come around my flock. I've allowed this lion to come along and take something from me that you put in me. See, God wants you whole. God wants you righteous. God wants you pure. God wants your heart filled with peace. If there's something been disrupting that peace, you've been allowing it, don't just say, Lord, by your anointing, I don't want to be proud of you. I don't want to be jealous anymore. I want to be secure in you. I want to trust you, Lord. I need an inner work. God is so good. He's so gracious. He loves you so much. He wants you to win. He's not throwing stones at you. We all deserve to be stoned, but he's not throwing stones at you. But he does want you to know what a stone feels like so you can throw it at the lion and the bear that's robbing the flock.